The AI revolution has been pretty mind-blowing, but there's a dark side you might not realize. All the servers needed to train and run these generative AI models require unbelievable amounts of energy. But it's not just that. It's the rate at which the sector is growing. It's a gold rush, with hundreds of companies wanting to stake their claim. And when you have a gold rush, all stewardship and responsibility go out the window. And don't forget that we already have massive data centers. We're already trying to move internal combustion engine cars over to EVs and use heat pumps instead of natural gas for heating and cooling. Our aging grid is already strained. And this may be one of the hottest summers in history. So what will the rise of AI mean for our power grids? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. I think Microsoft President Brad Smith summed it up perfectly when he said, "In 2020, we unveiled what we called our carbon moonshot." That was before the explosion of artificial intelligence. But last year, Microsoft took a massive step backwards in that regard by increasing its greenhouse gas emissions by 30%, due largely to AI pursuits. So in many ways, the moon is 5 times as far away as it was in 2020, if you just think of our own forecast for the expansion of AI and its electrical needs. So just how much energy does the AI revolution require? What if I told you that no one actually really knows? Companies that pride themselves on transparency are surprisingly tight-lipped about how much energy their AI data centers consume. Plus, it's actually really hard to calculate since the energy consumption is widely variable. But that doesn't mean we can't try to make an educated guess. Currently, data centers consume between 1 and 1.5% of all the electricity on Earth, according to the International Energy Agency. So how much electricity did the Earth actually use in 2023? Let's ask ChatGPT. It's all over the place. It gives you different answers. So I tried it a few different times. The first time I had 28,500 terawatt hours. The second time I got 26,000. It browsed different websites and stuff. A little bit tricky, but let's go with 28,500 terawatt hours. Now, if I do that same search on Google, so obviously a little tricky to pin down exactly, as you can imagine, worldwide energy consumption, but let's go with 28,500 terawatt hours. But did you know that that first ChatGPT request consumes between 10 and 25 times as much energy as that Google searched it, depending on who you ask? And get this, for a 20 query conversation with ChatGPT, you'd consume roughly 0.5 liter of water, which almost doesn't even make sense, but we'll get back to that in a minute. According to Stanford University, fine-tuning GPT-3 took 1,287 megawatt hours of electricity. And this technology consumes more energy with each new step in its development. GPT-2, for instance, was 1.5 billion parameters, while GPT-3 has 175 billion parameters. This complexity leads to amazing use cases like image and video generation, but it also comes at the cost of increased energy consumption. Consulting firm Gartner calculated that at this rate, AI will account for up to 3.5% of global electricity worldwide by 2030, and that's as much as agriculture and forestry combined, or twice as much as the entire country of France. That means that based on a 20-year average of about 2% increases year over year in energy usage, the entire world would consume 33,330 terawatt hours of electricity, and AI alone would consume 1,167 terawatt hours. If we looked at electricity used by country for 2022, the latest data I could find, that would put AI electricity use behind only the countries of China, the US, and India. It would rank 4th. Put another way, according to the EIA, the average home in the United States consumes around 883 kilowatt hours per month, or roughly 10.6 megawatt hours per year. That means the electricity used in AI would be enough to power 110 million of the 131 million households in the entire United States. The troubling part is that, like I mentioned, this is a gold rush, which means companies are going to be battling for their piece of the pie, consequences be damned. The age of corporate responsibility, where companies were growing their data centers and energy footprint along with their sustainability plans with new energy generation, sadly might be over. New wind and solar farms won't possibly be able to keep up with this level of massive growth. All this data doesn't just consume energy. It needs to be stored on hard drives, kind of like forever. And this can include our personal information. It's why I've been a member of our sponsor this week, Delete Me, for over a year.
It's crazy to me that collecting people's personal information and selling it online is a legit business, but here we are. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that will remove your personal information that's being sold online. And it's not just a one-time thing. Delete Me continues to monitor the web and remove your data as needed. I just got my fifth quarterly report, and Delete Me scanned over 10,000 listings. And I was shocked to see that the most commonly exposed information for me was my address. Delete Me just announced an exciting expansion of their core services to easily extend protection and peace of mind to anyone you wish to include, because it's not just about you, it's a family affair. Have you ever heard the expression, if something is free, you're the product being sold? So join Delete Me and save 20% on all plans with my code Ricky. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you. Now back to the show.
And when I say gold rush, I mean it. For example, look at the king of internet search. Google made $175 billion just from search. If the internet is the greatest marketplace of all time, well then Google is the gatekeeper. Their dominance in internet search has been viewed as an insurmountable moat for so long that it's become the target of antitrust legislation. But for the first time in two decades, their $170 billion pie might be up for grabs. Remember earlier when I tried Googling something and then asked ChatGPT? Well, using AI to find answers might very well use the same indexing and search optimizations that have made Google a trillion-dollar company, but it bypasses all the ads. Just look at this. This is what I get when I search for solar panels. Look at that first page, sponsor, sponsor, sponsor. There's not a single thing, right? This entire first page is sponsored ads paid for by companies and then their popular product section. I'd have to keep scrolling down to page two to get the first actual result. But with ChatGPT, this entire money printing enterprise is entirely bypassed. And Google knows this. And that's why they're investing billions in new AI data centers, like their $1 billion data center campus in Kansas City, Missouri, or their $576 million data center project in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. The rise of AI is going to place a major strain on the already strained grid. And we have to remember that other electrification initiatives are already underway, like the rise of EV sales. EVs accounted for 5% of all cars sold in the US in 2022, and nearly 14 million EVs were sold worldwide in 2023. The luxury of EV growth has been its slow and steady rise, giving companies and municipalities time to invest in the grid, increase energy generation, and install charging stations. But AI is going to be different because AI is a gold rush. Imagine if your boss said, this month you can work as many hours as you want, and I'll pay you 10 times your normal hourly rate. Wouldn't you be tempted to stop going to the gym, skip family time, cancel meditation classes, and just work? Now, big tech has been a little quiet when it comes to the energy demand of all their new AI data center ambitions. Companies like Google, Meta, Amazon, and Microsoft all have environmental impact goals in their charter. They say they buy enough wind, solar, or geothermal power every time a new big data center goes online to offset the resulting emissions. But there's a problem with all these renewable energy contracts. Big AI is pulling energy from the same grid as everyone else. And by buying green energy contracts, they're using up more of the finite amount of green energy generation available. To then fulfill the needs of their other customers, utilities are then filling out their energy portfolio with fossil fuel expansion, or in some cases, by extending the life of coal power plants that were planned to be shut down. So while big companies may claim in their marketing that their new AI data centers are clean, that comes at the expense of everyone else getting their energy from dirtier sources. One other trend I've noticed more and more is moving from more general to more custom large language models. Many companies are taking these LLMs and training it only on relevant data sets based on their industry. If you ever see an ad for a new AI platform tailored for enterprise or for image generation or education, that's a new model that requires new training. It's like having a general contractor who can do everything versus hiring an electrician and a plumber and a welder. Each new custom model will require all that training over and over again. But there is some good news. Have you ever heard the expression that the people who actually really get rich during a gold rush are the people who sell shovels? Well, in this AI analogy, the shovel salesman are Nvidia, a company that has absolutely skyrocketed in recent months due to their absolute dominance in AI-tailored GPUs for data centers. Nvidia reportedly has 98% market share of the AI GPU market and shipped almost 4 million AI GPUs in 2023. And this number is only going to be climbing. Nvidia is hard at work on constantly improving their hardware and improving the performance per watt of their GPUs. For example, their latest B200 GPUs based on their Blackwell architecture offers up to 20 petaflops of FP4 horsepower from its 208 billion transistors. And Nvidia says training a 1.8 trillion parameter model would have previously taken 8,000 Hopper GPUs and 15 megawatts of power. Today, Nvidia CEO says just 2,000 Blackwell GPUs can do the same task while only consuming 4 megawatts. But these GPUs don't operate in a vacuum and are clustered together in massive server racks. Nvidia says that in previous server clusters of just 16 GPUs, nearly 60% of all that time was spent communicating with one another, leaving only about 40% left for the actual compute workload. Now with a whole system approach, Nvidia actually has custom switch chips with 50 billion transistors themselves on board to be able to help with this. These optimizations will greatly increase the amount of actual AI workload performed per watt of energy consumed. And in this gold rush, Nvidia isn't alone, with competitors like Intel trying to catch up with their Gaudi 3 line of data center GPUs or the Instinct MI300 line from AMD. And this really matters because the limiting factor for the growth of AI data centers might simply come down to the supply chain and how quickly companies like Nvidia can produce their AI GPUs. Another really fascinating area of study is analog computers, which sounds counterintuitive, but once a model is trained with digital computers, with some clever electrical engineering, analog processors could run the AI models at a fraction of the energy cost. If you're curious about this, we have an entire deep dive video that you're gonna love. I'm gonna put that link in the description and up here. And check this out, a fan of the channel sent me this article about research being done by the University of California, Santa Cruz, UC Davis, Luxitech, and Soochow University that could have deep implications for the environmental impact and operational cost of AI. Huge thanks to Tony Herstel for sharing this with me. At its core, what makes GPUs so good at rendering video games, performing transforms, 3D, and light tracing is its ability to perform complex mathematical operations quickly and in parallel. This same ability makes it great at matrix multiplication, which is at the core of neural network operations. Definitely check out our video on analog computers because we do a whole deep dive into how they work. But these researchers claim to have developed a new way of running AI language models more efficiently by eliminating matrix multiplication from the process. This fundamentally redesigns neural network operations as they are currently accelerated by GPU chips. This would be like a breakthrough energy source that needed gold in order to be produced, and then discovering a new way to do the same thing using something much more abundant like aluminum. This would profoundly change the equation for what the future of AI energy consumption might look like. Sound off in the comments below if you want me to do a deep dive on this paper, because it's freaking fascinating and a little beyond the scope of this video. Also, a company called Soluna that we've covered in the past, which we'll link down below, sees this challenge coming and has their own novel solution. Surprisingly, many wind and solar farms have to stop exporting energy at times when there isn't enough demand. It's one of the great challenges of renewable and intermittent energy. So Soluna has a pilot plant we toured in Amarillo, Texas, where they have co-located a large computer cluster that fires up only during times of low demand. This means we could run AI training models during times of excess energy, better utilizing that energy instead of wasting it, and remove the need on the demand side. Plus, it levelizes the revenue model for these renewable energy operators, making it more lucrative and incentivizes future investment. And remember when I mentioned the water use? Well, that comes from cooling, where evaporative coolers are often used to draw out the massive amounts of heat that these data centers produce, instead of running heat pumps, which consume significantly more energy. But whether we use heat pumps for cooling or evaporate water, it all comes at a cost. Leave me a comment if you want to see a video where we talk about how this waste heat could actually be a novel new form of energy that we could use for heating homes or producing electricity. There's so much we could do if we just got a little bit more clever. We live in an amazing time with so many amazing people and companies working on so many things, and AI is here to stay. But should we be optimistic? Well, what it means for society is probably a topic for another day. But in terms of energy use and its impact on our grids, I'd say we've always found ways in the past, and this should be no different. Like I mentioned, we have a few videos that are highly related and would make for excellent viewing after this one. Until next week, I'm Rico Tuba da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.